group, to our family, to our community. Welcome.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Antonio. First of all, thank you to all of you for being here. Antonio was telling me this is very, very like family. Just take your cup of coffee and we start. So if you have your cup of coffee or your cup of tea or whatever, when Antonio says start, we start.
So Monica, well, you're calling from Madrid, right?
Yeah.
And one question we always ask is, can you introduce yourself? It's always nicer. They all have seen bios and so, but tell us a bit about your experience, your career, some of the big changes, the things that you learn from. So just a brief introduction on your experience and career.
For sure. Well, I am from León, a very small town in the north of Spain, and I wanted to become a notary. So I was studying for becoming a notary for 9 years, 14 hours a day, No holidays, just 1 week a year. I got married during my studies, and I had 9 days for a honeymoon. And after all this effort, I didn't pass the exam because I didn't know how to speak to the students. I was really, really scared of public speaking. So I had to change all my life and try to do other things. I wanted to be useful in any way. So I started working for the Red Cross with immigrants in León, and I did my career there as director of volunteer training, secretary in Cádiz in the south of Spain, legal affairs director again, and then I had the opportunity to go to Madrid with my son. I lost my husband, I'm a widow, so I have to change again my life, and I went to Madrid with my son. I had the opportunity to know about design for change. I'm going to tell you after how I started knowing about design for change. And here I am with design for change for the last 9 years now. And very happy to share with you what is the experience with this international movement.
Very nice. And can you tell us a bit about Design for Change?
Yeah.
You have slides? You can share slides, you can talk. I know Mark will also share some of his views, but as you want, you know.
Yeah, I'm going to share with you a presentation, but I prefer to talk. Okay. I like to talk about design for change. I am going to put it so you have beautiful images about design for change. And I am going to share with you some videos. Just let me put the Zoom sharing my screen. You have to tell me if you can see my screen. Do you see my screen?
Yeah.
Can
you?
Yes, yeah. I can see your screen.
Perfect. So here we go. Just wait a minute. I am going to put it like this, full screen. Okay, Design for Change. Design for Change is an international movement that give the kids the opportunity to put into action their own ideas to make of the world a better place, starting in their own community. I think that this definition that we use about design for change has three key elements for me. The first of all is that it's international. It's not in just one country. We are almost in more than 60 countries right now. The second one is that it's an opportunity for kids. As adults, we used to think that kids are helpless, that they cannot do anything at all. And we try to do everything for them. And that's not the idea that we are sharing with the world. We think that kids are not helpless, that they can do a lot of things. And the last idea is that we are not asking them to give solution to general or universal problems like war or like hunger in the world. We are asking them, what is bothering you in your community, in your surroundings, or in your neighborhood, in your school, and how you can improve these things. Design for change is starting with this key idea. Children are not helpless, change is possible, and they can drive it. Why? If you think about it, and I always like when Kiran, that is our founder, talks about this. If you think in a three-year-old kid, in a kid from zero to three, they learn to do almost everything. They learn to smile, to love, to run, to cry, to jump, everything. For 3 years, they are beautiful learners. And they are all the time learning by doing. And when they are 3 years old, we put them on a desk at the school. And for 15 years, we tell them, stay quiet, don't say a thing. And now we are going to tell you what to do and you are going to obey. And when they are 18, we tell them, you are a man or you are a woman, you go to the university and you have to be in charge of your life. And we think that it's not fair. We don't give them the opportunity to, for these 15 years, improve all the capacities that they have. And that is what we are trying to do. Design for Change, as I was telling you, was started by a woman in India, Kiran Birseti. Kiran was a designer with a company that designed branding for other companies when she became a mother. And when her first son, Rag, went to school, the first meeting with the teacher of her son was shocked by a shocking meeting for her, because she asked the teacher, imagine, first son, first year in the school, and how is my son? What does he like to do? Who are his friends? And the answer of the teacher was, what is the number of your son? So she was wondering, what can I do? Have I to stay and just, this is the system, and do nothing? Or I can do something, I am prepared to do something to change this. And the solution was the second one. So she decided to put a school in the garden of her house. If you go to Riverside School in Ahmedabad, you can see the picture of the house of Kiran with the garden, and the second picture with the house of Kiran with the school in the garden. That is what she started. And school using the methodology that she was using for making the branding of the companies she was working for. That was design thinking. She took design thinking methodology and simplified it to be used by a three-year-old kid. And she called it FITS. Feel, imagine, do, and share. The four steps or the four phases that Design for Change methodology has. FITS for Kids is what we call it. She was called to be one of the Ashoka Fellows and to give a TED talk. And then the world discovered that she was running school and running a little contest with the schools in India that using this methodology, we're doing really, really amazing things. And when she realized that she could open it, she opened it to the world as an international movement, as an international movement that is designed for change. 11 years, from 2009 till now. And from India to, as I was telling you, more than 60 countries. I think today is 72 countries and territories, because we have China, but we have Hong Kong and we have Macau. We have partners in all of them that have their own teams. And with these teams, they are managing Design for Change and making this contest in their own countries. And I'm going to share with you the impact. It's 72,000 teachers, more than 35,000 stories. We don't have the capacity to upload all the stories we have to the stories platform that we are managing. So it's impossible for us. I think we have 17,000 stories right now, but 35,000 stories, it's impossible to upload to the stories platform. And what are we doing right now? Well, this methodology is unleashing the activist that every child has inside. How? The methodology, as I was telling you, is design thinking, simplified methodology. I am going to put you a video. Mark, I think you like this one. And I am going to tell you why I am going to put you this video. It's just 1 minute and 20 seconds. Three-year-old kids. Can you imagine? I remember with my when my son, that now is 21 year old, was three, and he was all the time moving 75 centimeters tall, and it was impossible to think that he was able to do anything at all. Well, when I was in Madrid working for another company, Pedro Alonso, that is the man that brought Design for Change to Spain, put a laptop in front of me and put this video. And when I finished watching the video, I asked him, what do you want? And he told me, coordinator for Design for Change Spain. And I say, okay, you have it. And I started with this video. So this video is very important for me. What I was thinking when I saw, when I watched this video for the very, very first time was, they are 3 year old. Imagine that they can use this methodology, do the same for the next 15 years. What could they achieve if they are iterating the methodology year by year and improving it with all the knowledge and all the technology that they are learning in other fields? So this year I went to our international event for the very first time in India, and I had the answer there. There were a team of Denmark kids that were like Vikings. They were 17 year old. They were 2 meters tall, not my 3 year old and 75 centimeters kids. And they had a problem that was similar. They live in a place in Denmark that was full of forest. And the beans, the trash cans in the forest were very full in the paths that everyone was using, but were empty in the paths that nobody used. But the company that was in charge of the trash collection has not a way to separate one from the other. So they made a QR code. They put it in all the bins, all the trash cans in the forest. And when you were going for a walk and you can see a trash can that was full, just with the mobile app that they developed, you could take a picture, and there were an alarm in the company, so they knew what were the trash cans that they had to collect. They were negotiating the selling of the app with the government of Denmark. That was the result of knowing how to apply the methodology and do it to make something that is good for your community. And at the same time, you are an entrepreneur. Everything was in its place this year. Why we are now in so many places in just 11 years? Well, the answer is that the methodology is not only simple, it's open source, of course, and you can implement it everywhere where the technological development is not very, very high. At the same time, this methodology, as I was telling you, four steps: feel, imagine, do, assert. Feel, you go out and you look the world with another eyes to see what you can improve or you can change. The second one is imagine, and here you look for what is the solution, the best solution for the problem, brainstorming and doing exercise for improving the creativity. Then do, and this is a difference with other movements and other methodologies. Here is not a movement that says somebody has to or to do, or we are waiting for someone to do something. The kids have to do something. They have to use the solution that they have decided for solving the problem, and they make not a project, but a real, real story of change in their community. And the last one is share, that it's very important for us because share is the way to make other people, other kids and other educators or teachers or adults to be aware that they can do something. So it's the way to convince others to do projects also. So we are developing the 21st century skills: empathy, creativity, critical thinking, problem solving, with empathy, with ethics, with excellence, with elevation. That are the four steps that we use. Now 2 million kids, no 2 billion, I'm so sorry. We are trying to help with our 2 million. 2 million kids are doing projects all over the world. And with these projects, they are improving real, real problems in the community. I love one project from Colombia that it's called Ciga Bionica. Ciga Bionica was made by in 2014, I think, by children from a little village in Colombia with mines, and it was deforested by the mines. So they decided that they wanted their village green again. So they used a plain toy and a bottle of a plastic bottle full of seeds, and were flying this toy plane for 8 months all over the village with the seeds. And now it's reforested, it's green again. So this is one of the, I love that project. There are a lot of them. I am going to show you more later. What are the things that kids are worried about? Everything. Environmental issues are tackled in a lot of our projects. The life of elders is something that kids are very interested in. And due to all this, we have been nominated as in 2015 as one of the initiatives of to get one of the SDGs, the SDG number for education, by the United Nations. This is the impact, and this is what we are, where we are right now, is here. And this is something that we don't tell usually, but I like to talk about this. We usually say that we are improving in kids' empathy, creativity, critical thinking, or problem solving, but we don't say that we are doing something that is very special, that it's global citizenship. It's another of the 21st skills, and we do it with these international celebrations, the BTC, the Be the Change celebration. This is not a competition. The celebration is a celebration of what the kids have got during the year. So every year we have a celebration. The first three were in India. Then we shift to Monterrey, Mexico, Madrid, Beijing. The last one was in Taipei. And this next one is going to be the 20th of November, and it's going to be virtual for the very first time. I don't know how it's going to work because we were not prepared for this. Now we have to develop and try to maintain all the optimism of the kids during a virtual celebration. Last year was a very special year for us. We launched a different kind of celebration. We call it the ICANN Children's Global Summit. Usually in our celebration, we have 400 or 500 or people, teachers and students that are presenting their projects. But this time, it was a massive gathering. In 2017, we signed an agreement with the International Office of the Catholic Schools because they realized that they don't have a methodology that is unique for all of them. And when they discovered Design for Change, we work with all faiths, all backgrounds, all races. So we are not a Catholic institution or movement or something like that. But they decide to use our methodology as common for all the schools, the Catholic schools. So we signed this agreement and they invite us to do this gathering in Rome. Mark was there. She can tell you how was the experience. We had 2,500 kids at the same time in 13 different venues presenting 207 projects in 27 languages and from 40 countries. It was a very, very great effort for the global team. We are six people. Can you imagine six people preparing all this? But it was amazing, just how the kids presenting the projects, how they manage the situations. The anchors were kids. Everyone there were all the main positions in this event were kids. And I want to share with you. I have to go out from here, and I enter later. Well, I show it. I show it later for to you. The video of the event in Rome. At the same time, we are trying to be very serious. So what we are doing impact studies to know what we are doing, what we are putting up out there into the world, because we are. Talking about kids, and they are not our future. We think they are our present. So we have been doing impact studies. The first one with Harvard, the Project Zero from Professor Howard Gardner, and we have one in France that was a very interesting one about self-efficacy. Another one in Colombia and Israel. Spain is doing their own study, and. All the studies said that the development of children's skills is clear in empathy, in planning, collaboration, creativity, and critical thinking. So we think that the path to go with Design for Change is this one. Now we have a lot of challenges. This year, due to the COVID, we have to change our plans. And most of our partners have developed different projects to do during the COVID. We have the amazing Do Good From Home in the USA, DFC Connect in Singapore, Impulsa Cambio in Spain, the Dreams Diary in Brazil. All of them trying to get the kids doing projects with us. In some way and improving their skills. What are our challenges right now? To improve our footprint, we need to be in all the countries. The idea is every kid has the right to use the methodology. So we want to put the methodology in the hands of all the kids in the world. Data analytics, we need to know what we are doing well. Support to the partners that we already have, because it's what global usually does, and go on with the measure of the impact that we are having. So this is my last message for you. kids do not need permission to make the world a better place. We just have to let them do it. And I want to finish with another video of a project that I saw the girl that was the protagonist of this video presenting the project in a BTC in India. After the video, she told us, this is me and my buddies at the school did this project for me. And I still have goosebumps whenever I see this video.
Wow, impressive. Thank you. Wow, there's like no words to describe this kind of project. Thank you, Monica. Let me I think people need to digest this kind of messages, so powerful. It's just touching the both projects that we see. Let me introduce briefly Mark or invite him to talk, because he's been the bridge and he's a big ambassador of kids. So Mark, what do you want to say about whatever Monica, DC for change?
Thank you, Antonio. Thank you, Monica, for that lovely presentation. I've looked around the world. I have the 2 billion kids project. I'm trying to help kids around the world. And I see a lot of groups working with kids in different ways. When I came across Design for Change, it was something totally different for me. And I recommend that everybody do it. When I went to their first conference, it was all kids. It wasn't the people that you usually see at education conferences with white hair or no hair. It was all kids. And they're extraordinary in what they have been able to do and the scale to which they have been able to get. Of course, we want to get bigger. So if any of you, what I would really say here is, if any of you in any country wants to really do something powerful with kids, from the kids' point of view, not from the adults' point of view. This is not SDG number 4, give everybody an education. This is kids looking around and seeing other kids committing suicide, or other kids being forced into marriage, or other kids having real problems. And then, because of this very simple and useful methodology, being able to do something about this. And I don't know that Monica said this, but the whole philosophy behind Design for Change is I can. Yeah. That these kids really need to grow up with the idea that when they see a problem in their lives, whether it's a small problem, a family, a local or a national problem, they can take action to solve it and make it better. And so I highly recommend that whatever country you're in, contact Monica. Either there is an existing organization in that country, or you can be part of starting an organization in that country. There are some that still don't have it. I have never seen another organization that embodies the ideas and thinking that I have had for many years as much as this organization does. So I'm very happy that you're all, that you've all heard from Monica. And I hope that every one of you will figure out how to get some kids where you are involved in one of these projects. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. Remember me that I have to invite you to lunch or something for this.
It's, you have already invited me to Rome. That was wonderful.
Yeah, I am going to share with you one video of the Rome event or a BTC in Taiwan, so you can see how the kids are managing everything. And that's important because it's a way to say, as you are saying, I can.
Yeah, if you can, thank you. What comes to mind, Monica, Mark, everyone, is that there's some serious problems in society from environmental, and we don't see the senior leadership today making this changing. So I think we might need to focus more on the kids to bring these changes. They clean the ocean. It was a kid 16 years old, Greta. So I think maybe I'm reflecting now that instead of influencing the leaders that I don't like today because they're destroying our world, maybe their focus should be on these generations and empower them like you're doing with Design for Change, but bring them to a bigger scale because the future is there. The future is not in our current leaders. I think that we just need to manage to survive and then bring these new kids to drive the change that we need. It's just my personal reflection because it's a topic I'm very sensitive. I'm very upset with the way things go in the world. And this has just opened up into my mind, a big, big view.
I totally agree with you. I think that they are aware of what is happening in the world. And what is more important is that they want to take action. So if we give them the tools, the path to take action, they are going to do it. So for us, they are not the future. They are the present. And we have to count on them right now because they can do very, very beautiful things. Just think in the last video about forced marriage. It's incredible thinking that the bodies of Helen, this girl, decide to get her back to school and made all the project just to get this law in the small village with the elders saying that the forced marriages were forbidden. For me, it's impressive that kids could do something like this. So yes, I think I totally agree with you. I think they are our present. We have to work with them because they are going to change things for us.
If I can make one more comment, one of the things that many have observed is that kids today are fearful. All people are fearful today, but partially because of the parents' reaction to COVID, partially because of the problems that the adults have created in the world they have to solve. There are a lot of reasons. And the antidote to fear is empowerment. So as we empower the kids, as they learn that they can and take action, that will help overcome their fear of the future that we have given them.
Well, the idea is, how can we give them all the tools that they need to face anything that they have to face in the future? Because we don't know what they are going to face. What are the problems that they have to solve? If we are able to give them the tools, if they can work together, they can manage leadership, they are creative, they are empathetic, and they want to change things with all these tools, they are going to face any problem on earth. And that is what we need from them. I think the best present that we can give our kids, it's this. How can we empower them to face whatever they have to face?
Thank you. Let me bring some of the friends here. Srikant in India is talking about that he was not aware, so it's going to talk about that with their school and hopefully connect with you, Monica, or open up. I see Rosina, you have a comment here. Rosina, you want to share? And then Lourdes and Terry.
No, just, thank you for sharing. And I was saying that, I've been involved in some, as a designer also, just in some education programs, but it's also with special needs children. And it's a similar kind of idea of empowering. And I think we cannot go wrong. It's just that our education system needs completely redesigned. It's so kind of hierarchical and very traditional. And it's difficult to get governments to change. But what I found has been very useful is actually approaching directors of schools. They've been very open because they're crying out for this kind of thing. They're really crying out for the help and to have methodologies. And then the comment just that, yeah, of course, when it comes to like kind of women empowerment and all the things that we've been aware of over these last years. And certainly also I've seen that picture of Malala. Of course, there's been so much about, you know, girls, if you educate a girl, you educate a family. And it's a lot of what also the UN is really sort of working and promoting as well, especially UN women. So, I mean, it's fantastic, and we need to encourage more critical thinking. And the only way we do this is through education. And if we can't wait for governments, then indeed it's about as empowered people and as empowered citizens that we have to be the ones that create that change. And whether it's approaching our, you know, families, kids, schools and directors, which is how I did it, you generally find they're very open and they're very willing to have engagement because they also have a certain level of frustration with the system. So, and whilst, you know, you were presenting, I was, of course, looking if there's one in Belgium, and there is. So I will definitely reach out to the person who was the contact there, because I think, again, the power comes with people, with gathering together and the momentum. So it's super. I mean, I'm a total advocate for design thinking and for empowering our kids, and also not just in mainstream schools, but also special needs schools and children that are vulnerable, because I think they're often, very often left behind. And I'm very sort of public about it, that one of my sons has got mental health challenges he's also in a special needs school. And that's what encouraged me to try and make that change, because I used creativity to get him to try and feel confident and to, you know, go through this process of using the design thinking, the visualization, mixing, you know, his class with a mainstream school class so that we have inclusion, because it's really about also all children, you know, the ones that are, yes, certainly we've seen many that have been left behind during this COVID period, because the gaps got even bigger. When it comes to that education gap for children that are, as I say, that have been on the special needs. Sorry to take so much time, but I'm very passionate about this topic.
Well, I have to tell you that when I was coordinator in Spain, and we had to go to Beijing for the BTC, the jury surprised us selecting the project that we have to bring to Beijing, and was in a special needs school in Spain, and we brought two kids from this school to present the project. It was about protecting animals. I'm going to share the video with you. I'm going to send it to Antonio so he can share it with you, because one thing that always is going to surprise me about Design for Change is that as we started thinking that it was a methodology for kids from 8 to 15, and that was all, suddenly we had these videos, 3-year-old kids or special needs kids that are using the methodology because it's so simple, and it's empowering them. So when these kids from the special needs school in Spain discovered that they were able to change something, can you imagine how they feel? you can see it in the video because the video tells the story beautifully. So I'm going to send it to you. And I think you're going to like it.
And I'll send you a video in return via Antonio also of our workshop. So I'd be very happy to exchange.
Mm. Perfect.
Thank you. Thank you, Rosina. Lourdes, you had a comment?
Yes. Well, first of all, I like so much the presentation because both subject, I mean, the technical subject of design thinking is one of the things that I'm working as PMO in portfolio management, and I'm certified in design thinking. And I like really as a methodology for get things done, you know? So I think that I never imagined this for kids. So for me, it's a surprise. And in the other hand, I have the feelings that I need to help. And especially, I'm from Venezuela and live in Caracas. Really in this group that Antonio has for 37 weeks, I always have the feeling that someday this team is going to close, but the problems in my countries are going to be the same or even worse, because it has nothing to do with the COVID-19 or with the pandemic. I mean, we have been a crisis for years, and every day is going to be worse. So always think, well, how I can help people, how I can make an impact. And I think that really touched me so much. So it's how I can start.
Thank you so much. First of all, we have a partner in Venezuela. So please, Antonio, give my email and I can put whoever is interested in touch with our partner in each country so they can start helping and working with us. It would be a pleasure to have all of you helping, you know. We have only 2 million. If we want to get the 2 billion kids to have the tool in their hands and be able to change the world without the adult help that we are always trying to put in the middle, then we need all of you. We need all the hands. We need all the support. We need everything. We are starting, although we have started 11 years ago, there's so much to do to bring simple tool that make so great impact that whoever wants to help is really, really welcome. And if you know about design thinking, you know that this tool, that this simplification, Howard Gardner says that it's the best simplification of design thinking in the world. And it's because it's so simple, because it's has so great impact.
Thank you, Lourdes. Thank you, Monica. Lourdes, we're not going to leave you alone. So if there's something we can do, maybe we can have a special session just on what can we do to help around you. I know it's maybe just talking, but maybe something comes out. So this is part of this group. We're trying to help wherever we can. So happy to schedule just a call to brainstorm on how can we help in Venezuela, in Caracas, around you, maybe some connections, whatever. So we'll do that.
Thank you. Appreciate that.
Good. Thierry, you want to comment? And then Paula will be the last one because we need to finish. Yeah.
Yes, thank you very much. You know, I'd like us all to go back in time a little bit. You know, when we were kids, we were all activists. Okay. Life and society changed a lot about who we are and how we work as we progressed in the world. Here's the difference, my friends. There's many, 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 many times more activists now today than there were then. And they don't buy into what the grown-ups are saying. This is a good world to be and to watch right now. And the more encouragement we can give through this vehicle, the internet, to Monica and Mark's great works and Lourdes, you know, stepping to the fore, we are still those kids, and we are still those activists in our hearts. Just allow them to be. The greatest gift we can give the youngest, the new generation coming out, is let them be the activists they already are. And wherever we can help them is really what our jobs are as elders in society, is start getting those kids to not buy in, grab their phones and keep talking to each other and showing the world what's happening in real time that could not happen in my time. Most everyone here are too old for their childhood. There was no internet and those kinds of things like there is now. Malala and all of these folks around the world can show the wrongs of the world in real time. Can't be hidden anymore. It's very exciting. Thanks for letting me talk. I've got to run. I'm setting up for another meeting. That's why I'm dressed all pretty today. Blessings to you all. Great work, Monica.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Telling something. We are all activists when we are kids, and that is important. But there is a difference between the activist I was when I was a kid and this kind of activism. I think that my activism was directed by my teachers. They said, you have to do that, you can do that, do this. And Design for Change is giving the kids the decision of being activists to choose the problem and decide how to solve it. And I think this is a very, very special difference.
Thank you, Monica. And I pass. Paula has one comment, a quick one. We need to finish on time. Paula, you're calling from?
I'm calling from Canada. Hi, Monica. Canada. Hola.
Hi. Hola.
Monica, my question has to do with one of the projects that you mentioned in passing, the one in Colombia where they use a toy plane to reseed the area around the village. And so apart from the fact that's an ingenious way of doing that during COVID times, because it doesn't require people being in contact with one another, it's also a very empowering option for kids. What I was wondering was whether or not you could describe how these kids decided that they wanted it, what motivated them to do this, and in their village, that is, like what was the impetus? And have you looked at connecting this type of practice of this, you know, a use case, because it's an excellent, successful use case, with other reforestation, regenerative agriculture and forestry projects around the world? Because there are active movements around the world, like, you know, the scientist, well-known scientist, Diana Beresford Kroger, who's a genius in her own right, but has lots of skills with regard to trees, and that's her shtick. She has a documentary and has a book that actually came out recently about this, and has been on speaking tours of the imminency of carbon capture that can be resolved by reforestation. I can put the links to what I'm referring to in the chat so that you can have an idea of what the documentary is and who she is. But there, I was also in contact, I'm actually involved in a reforestation project in Peru. For a desert, a coastal desert bioregion that they want to regenerate. So there is also someone in Canada where I live, in Saskatchewan, that's actively working on a worldwide broad reforestation project in Mexico, in other places in Canada, and they're doing a study. We just had a conversation with her last week. I would be happy to connect you all. I'm just wondering if you've had this opportunity to actually connect these successful solutions to other things that as a model, not just, you know, on your website, but have you actually made the connection with other movements that are trying to actively encourage these types of actions around the world?
Yes, please, Paula, I thank you a lot for connecting us with whoever you think it's interesting for us. We are all the time opening our arms to all the organizations that can help us to impact everywhere. I have to tell you two things. One is that I am going to send to Antonio the video of the playing toy, so you can see all the video and how they develop it. And the other thing is that last year, you know, the worst thing of an NGO is funding. You know, that is very, very difficult. In COVID times, if you are working in education NGO, it's worse because now all the money is going to health and it's going to social problems. But education is the ugly sister. They are not looking at us. I think that education is the solution for the future, but I don't know how to give this message to the world. So last year when we were looking for funding, we launched a challenge with the X Prize Foundation in the USA, and it's about rainforest. All the solutions that kids can imagine for keeping the rainforest. I am going to send the link of this site, especially specifically to Antonio also, so he can share it with you. Because as I was telling you, environmental issues are very important for kids right now. And mm-hmm. as this video of the playing toys, we launched this challenge. And in this year, we were going to decide what was the best solution in our ATC that was going to take place in Rio de Janeiro in Brazil, but it was impossible due to COVID, so it's going to be next year. So we are giving the kids years to give us better solutions to fight for the rainforests. I think you're going to like it.
I'm sure I will. Just one other thing. So when I was referring to the bioplan, I put the links in the chat, by the way, with regard to the documentary to the mission and the bioplan that she has envisioned. See the documentary first, then you'll understand all the information on her website. And she's a fabulous resource person if you want to encourage her. She actually is wanting to encourage the whole world to plant a tree. One tree per year, every person around the world for 6 years. And that will significantly change, turn around climate change. If you see the documentary, you'll understand how. I thought I'd mention that. And it's not just the rainforest, because sometimes the rainforest is important, absolutely. But if we can do it all in our own localities, if each person realizes that planting a tree and, you know, regenerating forests in our own locality so that, you know, the world is, say, covered by, one, you know, to one third of its in tree, regenerative reforestation growth, then that actually will make a difference to our health and the health of our planet. Certainly according to all the scientists that are talking about it. So
I am sure of that. We have to start in one point, and rainforest was an opportunity.
Absolutely.
To put it on to put it into the world and say, come on, kids, give us the solution, the more creative solution to fight for our rainforest. I have put the link there so you can take a look.
Great.
I think you're going to like it.
Thank you, Paula. Thank you for sharing. I want to finish here. Thank you, Monica. Please send me the links and I'll put your email message. And I'm sure you'll get quite some contacts from this group. It's very active. And thank you for the time. Thank you for sharing. Thank you for what you're doing, Monica, Mark. I think you've changed my mind to look at the world right now. So I'm really looking forward to work closer with what you're doing. Thank you so much.
Antonio, thank you so much to you, and thank you to all the network. Please feel free to write me and ask me whatever you want. I will be, it would be a pleasure to answer to you all, and thank you for your time. Thank you.
Take care, everybody. Vaya, Thomas, Lourdes, Judy, Thomas.
Yours.
Adios.
See Muchísimas you. Gracias. Thank you.
Hasta próximo.
Bye.
Bye, Pradeep. Bye, Lars.